Welcome to Queen Anne's County 2017's History Day. This year we're at Queen Anne's County High School, and we have a bunch of new judges this year that have really made our projects awesome. We have judges this year from Washington College, we have judges from Chesapeake College, we have from the Naval Academy, we have from the Kent Island Heritage Organization, we have the Queen Anne's County Historical Society, we have the St. Michael's Maritime Museum, we have teachers from within our own building as well, our own buildings, I should say. We also have old-time baseball set up over here with Mr. Jim Apple, who is going to be showcase that, and you'll see that in a few minutes. This year, our projects are really, really, really well. We have some performances, which we have probably about 7 or 8. We have research papers. We have individual websites, group websites, individual documentaries, group documentaries, just to name a few, and posters and group posters as well. Now, Maryland Humanities, National History Day, and MSDE all provide us with opportunities and funding for this, so we want to thank them definitely as well. We have from Maryland Humanities, Judy Dobbs here, who's walking around and looking at our projects. And the winners this year are first and second place for each category. We'll move on to the State History Day competition held in UMBC at the early part of May. The students all have to develop a process paper, which is telling us how they do their research, an annotated bibliography, which is for their primary and secondary sources, and then they have to talk about the project roughly for about 10 minutes and then get questioned by judges. Those judges are trained by us before the event, and once that training occurs, they go off and judge our students' projects for about 20 minutes. So this year, it's a really intriguing and fun opportunity for all of our students. We have all of our secondary schools represented: Mattapique Middle, Sudlersville Middle, Centerville Middle, Stevensville Middle, Kent Island High School, and Queen Anne's County High School. So it's a really awesome opportunity for all of our students.
This year's theme is what?
This year's theme is Taking a Stand in History. That's developed by the National History Day Program and Maryland Humanities.
And this is going around across the country as well, eventually.
Correct. All 50 states take part, and any student that makes it to and through the state competition can make it to the nationals in June, and the June competition is at University of Maryland College Park, and there's even students who come from other countries as well. So this is a huge monumental type of event that we partake in every single year here in Queen Anne's County.
What do you think of our project so far?
Projects this year are very, very good. We've definitely got some great competition amongst the different categories, and I think we've got some excellent competitors that will do well at states, and hopefully we can move beyond that and head to nationals.
So there's no limit of how many kids could we send to the nationals?
Nationals are decided by the state of Maryland, and every single county in the state participates in that. So we have to hope that we can beat out the other counties of Maryland in order to send people off that way. We're still hoping to get somebody to nationals. I think we've had one throughout Queen Anne's County's tenure of doing History Day over the last 8 years, but hopefully this year we can send a couple of them off.
You want to thank anybody else?
I would like to thank Tina Thomas, our social studies supervisor. We'd like to thank Mr. Greg Paluski, Ms. Janet Pauls for the support they give for Queen Anne's County Public Schools. We'd like to thank the administrative staff here at Queen Anne's County High School, all the administrators at all the participating schools for providing this opportunity, and all the social studies department at the middle and high school levels for their participation and help as we move forward with these types of projects.
Tell us about the award ceremony.
The award ceremony, basically what we do is we have medals for first place and second place. Those two will head off, and medals for third place. Those students will then also receive a calendar, they'll receive a pen, and they also receive some other prizes donated from Maryland History Day.
So any of our finalists have plenty of time and how much help in making their projects ready for the statewide?
Students who make it to states are going to get their feedback forms, as all students will, from the judges probably in about a week, worst case 2 weeks. Then they can work with their local teachers who will help sign them up, and at that point they can work on the project to make it better based on the comments of these judges so that they can move on to the states and hopefully get the best type of project possible and win.
Go. Jackie Robinson is paid $7,200 a year. Right? It's going to blow your socks off. Average white male baseball player is paid $25,000 a year. But you know what? Jackie playing anyway. Pitcher, onto the field and yell, "Hey, Jackie, here's your cousin." What? Jackie played anyway. Today's Jackie Robinson is in the Hall of Fame, and his number is currently retired, so no one else can have his number. That is what
Jackie Robinson had to
do to take a
stand for all African American baseball players to
play in the major leagues.
Thank you all and have a good night.
Sloan also spoke and wrote for women's rights and many other liberal causes. In 1940, she strongly backed the United States entry into World War II. In January 1943, I visited death by the disabled soldiers of World War II in military hospitals around the country.
Colin was invited to join the 100th anniversary of the support from Paris. She was given a Medal Chevalier of the French Legion of Honor. She also delivered a speech in French honoring the life and legacy of Louis Braille, the creator of Braille.
This is an excerpt from her speech. I am touched by the honor you have given me. I cannot help by thinking that this honor is not due to any accomplishment of mine, but is rather for the encouragement and the depth of mind that I represent.
Colin was given an Oscar for the documentary that her life.
Across the United States, state commissions for the blind were created, rehabilitation centers were built, and education was made accessible to those with vision loss.
One of Helen's long-term impact is that she joined the American Foundation for the Blind, or the AFB. The AFB helps people that are suffering from vision loss.
1968 at Hatton Ridge, a few short weeks before her 88th birthday.
One of Helen's most loved and favorite quotes is,
"The only thing worse than being blind is having sight but no vision."
Goodbye, Helen Keller.
Good job.
I learned a lot in school and we wanted to learn more.
What's the most important thing that you've got out of studying for college?
You can do anything that you wanted to me. When she probably thought she could do anything, she was never blind, but she.
So how did she, she took a stand. How did she help people who came after her in terms of making it easier for, say, blind people or mute people or deaf people
or
whatever?
She created the American Foundation, which helps people with vision loss to get an education.
Do you have a favorite primary source, or when you went online to find primary sources, do you have one that was really easy to use, or one you like better than the others, or what?
Well, for a lot of her quotes, we used the book that she wrote, the story of her life, and the AFB has a lot of information on there, like on their website.
How long ago did you start this activity? Because it seems like you're really well researched and well prepared. How long ago did you begin this whole process?
My name is Darrell Calloway. I teach history at Sudlersville Middle School.
I'm Bob Lowe, and I'm a board member for the Kent Island Historic Society.
I'm Gail Owings. I'm the director of the Stories of the Chesapeake, the heritage area for Talbot, Kent, Queen Anne's, and Caroline counties.
So how hard is being a judge?
Isn't it refreshing to see the kids? They energize us. So how hard is it? Sometimes not too hard. But when they're all good, then it's really hard to differentiate. How do you make one number one? How do you make one number two? That's the difficult part.
It's not difficult. I think the kids do a good job. And our job is just to try to separate out the excellent ones for the good ones and ones that need more help. And that's part of our job, is to try to encourage them, give them some hints, things that they can improve.
So are you guys impressed so far?
Very.
Yes. Yeah.
Very much so.
Very much so.
It's very enjoyable.
Thank you.
Air plays. Vintage baseball. Airham baseball, 1864.
So,
a ball and a wooden bat. That's all the equipment you have.
So here at a history event, you play a historic game.
Yes. Yes, we play from up at Rochester, New York, where we won the championship last year, all the way to Washington, D.C. There are teams all over the Mid-Atlantic. We go to Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, and for one weekend, just like at Rochester, we're part of the exhibit.
A lot of people come to the games?
Sometimes. If you're at a festival or if you're like up at Rochester, you get quite a few. We don't have a lot because even though we play in Easton, we're hardly ever there. So it's hard to have a following that knows, oh, every time, you know, every Sunday or whatever, you're going to be having a game. It just doesn't happen that way. So sometimes we have quite a few, sometimes not so many.
The season starts in April?
Yes. We'll start in April, and we'll run through into, well, we'll probably stop right about the 1st of September.
Wow. Where can we find out more about the whole club?
We have a Facebook page, and we also are on the Vintage Baseball Association website. They have all the teams from the, all over the United States, really. And they have them there, so you could actually go to the state of Maryland. You could find out what team it is, where they are. There are several in the state of Maryland. Elkton has one. Arundel has one. And of course, we have one. Chesapeake, Potomac's over north of Baltimore. And Ellicott City even has one. That was the one we were flooded out last year. We were supposed to be there the Sunday they had the flood over there.
Is this area particularly hot with vintage baseball, or is it all over?
It's all over the United States. It starts in the Midwest and New England, and then it spreads from there. We're almost one of the furthest south. There are two teams, I believe, in North Carolina, but other than that, we're pretty close to the furthest south that there is. Now, when you get to the Midwest, up in New England, there are a lot more teams. Sometimes in one county, there might be three or four teams in the Midwest, whereas we have basically two for the Eastern Shore. Other teams on the West Coast that play what they call vintage,
right,
which actually is really the 1940s, 1950s game.
Okay.
But it's not like what we play.
What's your time period?
Ours, we play 1864. However, we have played rules from 1860 up through 1873. 1873, this is the ball we would use. It's very close to today. This is the one we would use for 1860. So
big changes in a short period.
It does change. It's interesting, as you watch the game progress through the years, they'll do something, and then they'll say, well, that didn't work very well. Let's go to something else. Like at first, there are no balls and strikes called. But then they realize, you know, they need to have balls and strikes to speed up the game. So then how many balls and strikes do you have? What do you do there? They keep changing that. The pitching distance changes. It goes from, we pitch out of a box that the front edge is 45 feet from home plate. Later they decide we're going to shorten or narrow the box and lengthen it so you can stride further, which means people can throw harder. Well, now they move it back to 50 feet from home plate. And when pitchers are throwing even harder, as they go from underhand to sidearm to overhand, that's too close.
Mm-hmm.
So then they move it back. It was supposed to be 60 feet, but somebody with their fancy handwriting had the zero look like a six, so it became 60 feet, 6 inches. And that's the
official.
We play down in Easton. As I said, we don't have a set day that we always play down there. Usually we play at 12 o'clock on Sunday afternoons, if we're there. You just have to check and see what the schedule would be. It was actually blonde hair instead of, as it is today,
right,
silver.
So this is a historic document by itself.
Yeah, that's right, that is. And we even have 1858 candy that we would have eaten during the game.
My name is Ashlyn Conley. I'm from Centerville Middle School, and I did my history project on Alice Paul, a woman who took a stand. So Alice Paul was a very incredible woman who spent her life on women's rights and the right for women to vote. And it was really fascinating to see how she did everything that she did and how us women got the right to vote and what struggles we had to go through to make it to the point that we're at today. And we're still dealing with inequalities today, but because of women like her, we don't have to deal with as many of them.
You think she'd be pretty active today?
Definitely. And even after we got the right to vote, she was continuing her work with the National Women's Party and with civil rights, and she also introduced the Civil Rights Amendment to the Congress after, too. So.
Can you imagine living in those days?
It would be pretty crazy to be a woman living in those days. We didn't have barely any rights, and the right to vote also just opened the eyes to many of the people in government that we need democracy in our country, and that this would have been really hard to live like this. I mean, we had no rights. We could walk in the streets, and we had to be accompanied by a man, too. So,
a whole different world.
Yeah, definitely.
And protection. We chose this project because we wanted to show people how the Chincoteague Fire Company stood up to help protect the wildlife and some of the animals on it. Some of the things that surprised us were?
Something that surprised us was that they have to put all their time and volunteer and how much they do for the ponies. Because they are a volunteer fire company, they do this on their own time. And it was surprising that they would take their time to preserve it if even they didn't have to.
It was also very surprising that there's so much wildlife there that they have to preserve, such as the ponies, of course, the Chincoteague Town ponies, the snowy egrets, the sandpipers, and also white-tailed deer, Delmar foxes, Delmarva squirrels, and red foxes. And it's just wild that they take all of their time, as Ava said, and put it into protecting this island.
I also found it pretty cool is that they do 3 roundups, and during those roundups, they check the horses for vaccinations, they take care of their hooves, they do checks to make sure the population's at a certain amount, so you can keep all the seagrass for the other wildlife. And they have 2 pony pennings and 3 roundups, which are completely different things. The pony penning is to auction off some of the horses to keep the population at a certain amount, and the roundups are to check on their health and well-being.
Those horses could go anywhere in the country, right?
Yeah. On an island, though, so they're kind of there.
They stay on the island.
Oh, they stay. Yeah, okay.
On the Virginia side, most.
There's 2 herds, the Virginia and the Maryland herd. So the island, the reason the horses stay on the island, the reason they had to protect this is to protect the horses. And the island was actually going to disappear because the island rolled over. And that's a process where the water comes up and kind of grabs the sediment and brings it back. So the island will disappear. And so they tried to preserve it. They created barriers and so that all the wildlife on there could live happily. And yeah.
Another way they tried to preserve it was they have a limit, 140 limit of ponies on, and they have right now 136 or 137, as we've heard from the Chincoteague Town interview, and they do that so the ponies will eat all the grass, so they can only have a certain amount and they can only have 140.
Some people think the ponies got there because there used to be a lot of ships going in there, and they use lighthouses and stars to navigate. So one day they think that one of the lighthouses that it might have been a little bit darker than other days, and most of these ships carried ponies.
So this island would be a great summer trip, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they have 2 national parks there, and so you can go there and look at all the wildlife. There's beaches. The one problem might be the bugs that are there. But the wildlife's really, really cool to look at.
They also do some boat tours.
Well, with going there, you can see see all the wildlife they do preserve, because it's not only just ponies and stuff. It's more, it's birds and deer and foxes, and geese, ducks, all kinds of like wildlife that they preserve.
And I think that's all that we have to say.
Dynastic!
Hi, my name is Mackenzie Barr. I'm from Mattapique Middle School, and my topic I did was Captain America. I chose Captain America because he is my favorite superhero, and he inspired me to become a leader, stand up for others, and to be a role model. The most surprising thing that I learned about him was that he was an inspiration to servicemen in World War II.
Hello, my name is Alexis Bridge, and this is Adrian Madigan, and we did the bombing of Pearl Harbor as our National History Project for taking a stand in history, and we did it because we both knew some about Pearl Harbor, but we wanted to learn more and how, like, it took a stand in history.
What interested me in this topic is my dad's kind of like a history freak, and so he really likes Pearl Harbor, so I wanted to learn more about that. And the U.S. took a stand in history because while the U.S. was trying to make peace with Japan, and Japan was on U.S. territory, and Japan's fleet ships were already over to Pearl Harbor, Hawaii, to attack. And
so the most interesting part for me was probably about how heavy these bombs are and how just that bomb could do so much damage. And I like seeing the different waves and how they struck and stuff, and how Japan just thought through this whole process a year before and did this and was making peace and then just went and got them.
And what surprised me is that after the bombing, it went into World War II after President Roosevelt declared war on Japan and its allies, Germany and Italy. What surprised me is that the men were fighting, so then the women would help, they would help and fix the damaged ships and do men's work while they were still doing the chores at home and still working their normal lives.
I bet you guys are looking at movies in a whole new way now, right? Yeah. TV, because you know the history.
Yes.
My name's McKaylee, this is Julia, and this is Ariana Shores. We chose this project because we thought it would have we thought it was the most important thing that we could have done to take a stand in history, to win our freedom from Britain. One thing that surprised us the most about this project was we found out that the Germans had originally planned to sneak into Lexington, but there were actually spies. The British had originally planned to sneak into Lexington, but there were spies in the British Council.
Go ahead.
The thing that surprised me was that when they had fought with them in Lexington, they didn't win at first, because I actually kind of didn't know that. But then they kind of they kept trying, and then eventually they did win and they gained power back in the country.
What surprised me was that these farmers were just fighting these advanced British people, and they were tough and didn't care what the consequences would be to attack against the ones who control them. But if the colonists didn't start fighting for our freedom, we would have been in control of the British today. Maybe we didn't do anything.
I'm out.
You're out. Who's
my daughter? Kicked me out.
I'm ready.
It's a tough room. It's a tough game. What is the game?
It's called Spy Alley.
Okay.
All right. It's the next one game.
I am Lucas Hensel.
Tell us about your project.
I did someone taking a stand against ladies.
Why'd you pick her?
I picked her. Well, I knew a little bit about her, but I knew that she fled when I was 76, and she was very brave, and she suffered to free other people. I think that she took a big stand in history, and that would be a good topic for this project.
So a local story, right?
She grew up in Cambridge, Maryland on Brodus Farm.
Very good. What surprised you the most? Doing your research, what surprised you the most?
The thing that surprised me the most is that she will be featured on the $20 bill in the year 2020.
I'm Judy Dobbs, and I'm with Maryland Humanities, that is the sponsor of Maryland History Day, the statewide competition, and then our statewide winners go on to the national competition at the University of Maryland College Park, competing with over 3,500 students from throughout the world, actually. It's not just a national competition, but they're competitors from other places in the world. Really excited to be here at the Queen Anne's County competition. This is the first county competition that started in Maryland, and then they'll be going throughout March, but we're very excited that Queen Anne's County has a growing participation in History Day. More and more students are doing better and better projects. These projects, the quality and the depth of research, it has really grown, and we're very excited to see it. Also really excited to see so much community involvement. There are judges from museums and historical societies and colleges and people with all kinds of expertise that are providing great feedback for these students. So it's wonderful to be here.
This year's theme is Take a Stand. Are you seeing good representation of that?
Oh, yes. Now, there are lots of people that come to mind right away when you think about taking a stand. Jackie Robinson and Helen Keller, I've seen projects on them here. But then there have been projects that I've noticed that are on individuals that you don't think of right away. I didn't know about Ms. Londonderry, who rode a bicycle all over the world. And so I'm learning a lot here from all this research that the students have been doing. Students, by their in-depth research, looking at primary sources and interviewing people and looking at secondary sources, they are teaching themselves, but they're teaching the rest of us, too. They're teaching their teachers and members of the community.
How does Maryland do nationwide?
We do well. We actually have the third highest participation of any state, so we're very proud about that. At the national competition, there's lots and lots of competition. We've won some medals. We've won some special prizes and teacher recognition. We do well, but mostly I think the most important thing is that this is an experience that many students are never going to forget.
How many of these events do you go to? Will you go to?
I'll be going to about six, but we have other staff members who are going to many of them as well, all around Maryland. That's because on some weekends there are, you know, six or eight competitions taking place at the same time. So this is truly a statewide movement, and we're very excited about the growth.
How can we find out more about Maryland Humanities?
You can look at our website, mdhumanities.org, and find out more about the many programs that we offer, not just History Day, but also on the Eastern Shore at the Chesapeake Bay Maritime Museum. Next summer in July, we're going to be featuring free living history performances, looking at the U.S. entry into World War I, and we've got Woodrow Wilson, General John Pershing, and W.E.B. Du Bois, and many, many other programs that we offer, so please check them out.
Hi, and welcome to Queen Anne's County District History Day. We are here celebrating social studies and social studies education with a lot of young people who have come out and really take their time over the past few months to present and come up with a project that works with the theme of to honor the theme of Take a Stand in History in our Queen Anne's County History Day competition. Most of our students in the county do get to participate in a History Day competition in their particular school from 6th to 8th grade. We also have a few projects here from the high school level, and we'd like to have more projects from the high school level, so we would love a lot of our senior categories to be filled. So today is our first step. No, today's our second step. Today is our second step in this competition. So most students had a competition at their school, and the ones that were chosen were sent here today so that students could defend their projects and defend their research in history. The next step, if they win today, the top two projects will move on to the state level. And then if they're able to accomplish there, they're going to move on to the national level. So they have a few months of History Day competition and History Day celebrations. Today, the judges will be giving the students who have won in their category feedback, and the students will be able to take that feedback over the next couple months, and they will be able to make their project a little bit better or something that they're able to present at the state level. Once they get to the state level, it is really tough competition. So students have come back over the years and have said the state competition was a great experience, but they knew that their project wasn't quite at that level, but they get there the next year. So that is a great experience for the kids. I would really like to thank Tom Price. Mr. Price works at Stevensville Middle School, and he's a social studies teacher. Without that, his work and his hard work of organizing everything today, we couldn't have pulled off this competition. I also would like to thank Mr. Anders and Mr. Heyman and Mr. Boyer from Centerville Middle School for their help in setting up and getting everything ready. I'd also like to thank the staff at Queen Anne's County High School for helping support us and being here while we take over the school for social studies. So we would like to really thank all the students, all the teachers, and all the people who help us behind the scenes, the parents, and we'll see you next year.
We are ready to roll. We got the judges' responses. So let's just say thank you to everyone in this room. Thank you to everyone who couldn't be in this room but still had a project. They had to leave for various reasons. Thank you, snow gods, for not snowing us out. It is February. So the first two, first place and second place, will be going to the state competition, which is held in April and May, first week of May. And I think it was April 29th. Well, anyway, we'll get back to you on that date. Anyway, thank you so much. The quality of projects, we've been doing this now, I think this is our eighth year, and the quality of projects have just blown me away every year. So give yourselves a big round of applause. Thank you for celebrating social studies. Keep social studies alive in your schools. Ask for it, make sure your kid is taking social studies. Anyway, we have some helpers here. They're going to give out the medals, and we're going to announce the first, second, and third place in each category. And remember, as I said, first and second will go to the state level for whatever reason. If they can't, then the third would take that place. So you will receive feedback forms from the judges, and you have an opportunity over the next month to fix your project. Because once you get to the state competition, it's not Queen Anne's County, it's the state. So they're pretty big and they're pretty good. So anyway, without further ado, I'm gonna turn it over to Mr. Kreis and he can call out the names.
Firstly, I'm gonna apologize if I say anybody's names wrong. I'm sure it will happen. We're gonna start first with individual exhibits. In third place, doing a project entitled Harriet Tubman Taking a Stand Against Slavery, Lucas Hetzel. In second place, doing a project entitled Alice Paul, Ashlyn Conley. In first place, doing a project entitled Annie Londonberry's Historic Ride, Caden Schulte. For group exhibits, in third place, with a project entitled The Third Estate Takes a Stand Against the French Government, Cole Swiderk and Jacob Bowman. In second place, doing a project entitled Pearl Harbor Taking a Stand in History, Alexis Bridge and Olivia Mattingly. And in first place, doing a project entitled Assateague Island, Olivia Marshall, Rivera, Abigail Reynolds, and Victoria Jones. For research papers. In third place, doing a project entitled Horace Mann and the Fight for Quality Education, Deborah Cook. In second place, doing a project entitled Amelia Earhart, Flying for the Female Freedom, Giselle Torres. And in first place, doing a project entitled Malala Yousafzai, The Bravest Girl in the World, Mary Redpath. For individual documentary, we did have two senior projects, students who participated at the high school level. In second place, a project entitled The Unexpected Hero, Dory Miller, Morgan Flegel. In first place, with a project entitled National Parks, Cody Pfeiffer. Cody, how many years have you been doing History Day?
Four now.
This is now his fourth year. For individual documentary for the junior level, the middle school level, in third place with a project entitled Gloria Richardson and the Cambridge Race Riots, Faith McCarthy. In second place, with a project entitled Taking a Stand in History, The Life and Legacy of Deborah Sampson, Amara Crow. And in first place, with a project entitled Navajo Code Talkers, William George. Our next category, Junior Group Documentary. In third place, with a project entitled The Wright Brothers Taking the World to New Heights, Will Collison, Dylan Herlock, Ethan Kendall, Thomas Linder, now I have his Dylan, his last name got cut off, sorry, and Dylan. In second place, with a project entitled Alexander Hamilton, Shelby Wagner and Amelia Sirocco. And in first place, with a project entitled Thermal Riots, Queer Uprising, Malia McCluskey, Cullen Williams, and Caitlin Price. The next category, junior individual websites. In third place, with a project entitled Jesse Owens Takes a Stand, Megan Molman. In second place, with a project entitled Helen Keller, Anna Lackey. And in first place, with a project entitled Women's Rights and Taking a Stand, Zoe Katz. The next category, junior group websites. With a project entitled Harriet Tubman, Rachel Nowak, and Melissa Barbones. In second place, doing a project on Susan B. Anthony, Natalie Rollins and Tara Palmateri. And in first place, doing a project on Sarah Edmonds, Georgia May and Hannah Shark. We have performances. We had one individual performance, and in first place, the project is entitled Benny Goodman. That's Kaylin Korcha. For group performances, in third place, doing a project entitled Spartacus, Jordan Hunter, Bill Kennedy, and McLean Muggett. Second place, doing a project entitled Helen Keller, Samantha LaCrone, Samantha Messier, and Haley Martino. And in first place, doing a project entitled Elizabeth Blackwell, Samantha Hare, Alyssa Sparks, and Sophia Serene. We would like to thank you all for coming out. Thank you to National History Day, Maryland Humanities, Queens County, and all the winners. If you could please come forward, anybody who got a medal, so we can get a picture of all the winners that are at the event. And thank you very much, and have a great rest of your day.
One, two, three, go.
How about thumbs up, guys?
Yeah.